What we call head and neck cancer is actually cancer of the mouth and throat. And it also includes cancer of the glands in the neck, lymph nodes, and also salivary glands and the thyroid gland. So one of the main symptoms that people come to Johns Hopkins to be seen for is a lump in their neck. Now, you have a number of different structures in the neck. We're concerned about lumps that grow larger than the width of your finger, larger than about 2 centimeters, and have lasted for more than 6 weeks or so. So a lump is one important symptom. Others are difficulty with swallowing and speech, pain, sore areas in the mouth, particularly areas that are red or white, perhaps something that your dentist has seen would be of concern. And then deep pain, pain that lasts for more than a few weeks, and particularly pain that radiates or seems to involve your ear on one side or the other. Deep ear pain is often missed as being something that might be in the throat, but can be a sign of head and neck cancer. There are about 50,000 cases of head and neck cancer in the United States each year. So with 400 million people, that's only about one in every 10,000. The people who are at risk for head and neck cancer traditionally have been people who have a history of tobacco use. Also, alcohol adding to smoking or using chewing tobacco increases the risk. So if you have a history of having smoked more than a pack a day for more than 10 years, you are at increased risk for head and neck cancer. In addition, we're finding more and more patients who have cancers of the tonsils and the lingual tonsil, or the back of the tongue, because of the human papillomavirus. HPV is a sexually transmitted virus, and it causes other kinds of cancer, such as cancer of the uterine cervix. It has quite a lag time, about 20 years from the time of exposure till the development of cancer in some individuals, and does affect people who are non-smokers. So most of the patients that we see nowadays with HPV-related cancer are men in their 5th, 6th, and 7th decades. Cancer of the mouth and throat is complex because of both the importance of offering curative therapy, but also maintaining good function. Your mouth and throat are obviously involved in a lot of important things, things that I'm doing right now, talking and being seen in public, but also eating and obviously breathing. And so we combine treatments to optimize cure, but also to maintain function. There are 4 basic types of treatment that are used for head and neck cancer. Surgery is one. Radiation therapy is a second, chemotherapy a third, and more recently, immunotherapy, which is similar to chemotherapy. It's a drug or treatment by intravenous therapy modality that's combined with others. Radiation and surgery are the 2 mainstays of head and neck cancer treatment. Chemotherapy by itself doesn't cure head and neck cancer, but can be used in combination with the other therapies. And so the treatment is designed based on the stage and the site to give us the best chance of curing the cancer, but also maintaining function. When we're deciding about surgery for the head and neck, we attempt to minimize the impact on the function, and a lot of the tools that we use are endoscopic. And so an effort to treat larynx cancer, for example, with a laser, or the new robotic surgery that is useful for cancers of the back of the throat. A lot of the cancers that we're seeing nowadays are arising in the tongue base, which is the vertical part of your tongue that drops down towards the voice box. It's way back in the back of the mouth and difficult to see. It's also difficult for the surgeon to reach that area with instruments. The robot gives us that opportunity by allowing an angled telescope to visualize the area, and instruments that come in from the side of the mouth and are controlled by the surgeon at a console next to the operating table. This allows us to remove portions of tumor in the back of the tongue, or the entire tumor in the back of the tongue, without having a bad impact or a negative impact on swallowing and speech. The first question people have when they are seeking treatment for head and neck cancer is, will I survive? Will I be cured? And that's obviously our top priority as well. But a second and important question is, what will my life be like after I'm done with therapy? Head and neck cancer therapy for more advanced tumors in particular is quite difficult to get through. And you really need the support of a multidisciplinary team with speech therapists and others, physical therapists, to help you with going through that therapy. Radiation therapy can leave a person with dryness and difficulty swallowing. Surgery obviously can impact speech and swallowing. And so we work to reduce the impact of those therapies by combining and focusing them to achieve the highest likelihood of cure and to maintain therapy or maintain function throughout the course of therapy. One of the important things, for example, is to keep swallowing while you're going through treatment. And so at Johns Hopkins, our swallowing therapists meet with each cancer patient at the multidisciplinary clinic at the beginning of your visit, and then meet with you regularly on a weekly basis during treatment to encourage and assist each individual to maintain their best function.